We're gonna put that one in pretty safe.
Catherine blocks the G.
Scenic music shell on the beach at Stratton Point. We're making the scene at the annual International Jazz Festival. From this historically fashionable summer resort, we'll be bringing you all the highlights of this year's Jazz Festival.
We're going to put that one in pretty safe.
Catherine blocks the G.
My name is... I'm a private. Eye. To be a private eye today, you don't have to know the criminal code. You don't have to be tough. You don't even have to own a gun. All you need is a good ear for music. Take my show, for instance. It may not be tops, but it's number one on the jukeboxes. I studied hard to be a detective. 3 years at Juilliard. And a summer session at the Newport Jazz Festival. The private eye business is very competitive today. It's dog-eat-dog. I don't mind another gumshoe stealing my clients, my gun, even my girl. But when they steal my music, that's too much. And that's why I happened to be heading out to Slick Pier the other day to see that famous bandleader, Lawrence Toccato. It took me quite a while to get there. His ballroom was way out. His music wasn't. I needed something different, a style of music that no one would steal. And I thought staccato might be the answer. When I pulled up to Slick Pier, I was greeted by the parking lot attendant.
Greetings, Daddy-O. Welcome to Squaresville.
Gookie, I didn't know you dug polka music.
Like the least. But you know, man, I need the bread. After all, Dad, I'm not only a fender bender, I'm also the first singer to bring back talking records.
Incidentally, Gookie, how do I get into this polka palace?
Just follow the bubbles, Dad. They're the only things around here that aren't square.
Careful with the T-bird. The brakes need adjusting.
Crazy, Dad. These wheels are the skizziest.
Well, some shark could always sell it to Lloyd Bridges. When I walked into the ballroom, Lawrence and the band were busy rehearsing for his TV show.
Thank you, Myron Chlorine, for that wonderful accordion solo. It was wonderful. And now here's our lovely little near beer lady. 3, 2...
dream of Johnny, who is so debonair. He has such charm and reeks with savoir faire. I love his smile and his naughty wink. I'd marry him tomorrow if he just didn't drink. Excuse me, I'll be right back.
Well, thank you, friends. That was our lovely little near beer lady, a girl who really has a head on her shoulders. Little humor there. Fellas, I got to see someone, so Rocky, will you rehearse with the band? Here's the sheet music for the Linen Sisters, a new number. Too young to smoke in bed.
Too young to smoke in bed. Too young to smoke in bed. Too young to smoke in bed.
To escape the music, Lawrence and I met in his dressing room. I introduced myself. My name is...
I didn't quite catch the name.
I said my name is...
Oh, yeah, you're... I've seen you on M Squad.
It was obvious he had his private eyes crossed. But that was unimportant. I was desperate. I needed music for my show in the worst way. And when you need music in the worst way, Staccato's your man. I was just about to wrap up the deal when suddenly...
Well, what happened to Rocky?
Another one of our tenors choked to death right in the middle of the big bubble finale.
Golly gee whiz, what'll we do? That's the eighth tenor we've lost this week. Now we've only got the three left.
I volunteered to help and immediately began to reconstruct the crime. First, I started the bubble machine. Lawrence, it's just as I thought. Do you notice a strange odor in the ballroom?
Please, no wisecracks about the music.
Lawrence, the case is solved. Those bubbles are full of poison gas. Every time a tenor hits a high C, the note pops a bubble.
I can't believe it. Who would want to break up such a happy family?
I thought to myself, the murderer had to be someone who doesn't like tenors. And that would narrow it down to about 150 million people. This case could keep me here all night. Then it came to me. Lawrence, I know who the murderer is.
Who?
There's your murderer. Your near beer lady.
Yeah, your near beer lady.
Heavens to Betsy, why did you kill all those tenors?
Because I'm the star of the show, and no one's going to sing higher than me.
And no one's going to get higher either.
That's right.
What am I going to do with her?
What else? Throw her in the jug. Well, I don't have to tell you that Lawrence's music was an instant success on my show. He wrote a new theme song called I'm Dancing with Tear Gas in My Eyes. And our television show was back on the jukeboxes again. So if you're not doing anything next week at this time, you can always find me at Lawrence Staccato's A 1, a 2, Sunset Strip.
Yeah, man. Hi, Grandpa.
Hi, sonny boy. I didn't mean to wake you up. I just came in to give you a good big hug and a kiss before I went to bed.
Did you scare him?
You bet your life I scared him. Mercy. Now you just go to sleep.
Mr. Cheney, conference call.
Oh, yeah, I'll be right there. You sleep good.
Peter, I've read your prospectus. I regret to say, old friend, speaking entirely for myself, of course, I find it rather wanting, if not indeed psychologically unsound in today's market.
But people don't change, Boris. What frightened them then, in the dark ages, it still frightens them now. Fear is born into people. Witch doctors, voodoo priests.
Zombies, ghosts. Vampires, monsters.
And don't you sell them short, Boris.
Rattles and drums. Old hat, my dear fellow, old hat. Look, I'm told that business is so bad that the witch doctors in Africa are asking for relief parcels. I see a schism as wide as this can't be bridged by telephone. We'll have to meet and come to a final and unanimous decision.
But, Boris, you know I can't stand London at this time of the year.
What's the matter, Peter? Too much fog to swirl a cape in? Very well. I'll fly to New York.
No. Why don't you come here to Hollywood?
See, I have an idea. Why not meet halfway? I know a place outside of Chicago, near to the airport.
Chicago? Splendid. By all means, make the reservations at once. Oh, but, Peter.
I suggest that you sign us in, as a committee,
a society in aid of the prevention of something or other. I'm sure Mrs. Baxter would advise us to do exactly that.
Oh, don't you think we ought to have her there, too?
Why, of course.
Without her legal and financial counsel, the whole project might get off on the wrong foot.
Oh, and Peter, in the interests of anonymity...
I think we should use our given names as surnames and reverse the spelling. You see what I mean? In that way, I be Mr. Searob.
And I shall be Mr. Retief.
And that'd make me Mr. Null.
Well, shall we see tomorrow afternoon in Chicago?
Splendid. Oh, Peter, what's the name of the place?
The O'Hare Inn.
Sir, I think I better sign the rest of my part in, too.
Of course, Mr. Retief. Mr. Retief, has anyone ever told you there's a striking resemblance between you and, you'll excuse me, sir, Peter Lorre?
That's pretty insulting, isn't it?
Front, please. Mr. Retief, 306.
Would that be reserved for our meetings?
Parlor 9, sir. An excellent view of the pool. And a Mr. Todd Stiles has been assigned as your group liaison. Anything you want, contact Mr. Stiles. We hope you enjoy your stay here, sir.
Mr. Retief? I'm Stiles from the inn. Your expediter?
Well, I like expediters. Come right in.
Well, our needs are really quite simple. All I need is a large table, four chairs, oh yes, and a very good lock on the inside of the door, because you see, the work of our society is quite secretive.
And the preservation of Garanooks?
You know about Garanooks?
Well, frankly, Mr. Retief, nobody around here knows what a Garanook is or does, including me. I'm a Yale man.
Well, that's all right.
Well, it isn't in the dictionary.
Don't you speak Somali?
I had trouble with the adverbs.
The explanation is quite simple. Garanook comes from a Somali expression, Garamook, and it means an antelope, a small gazelle in the eastern part of Africa, Lithocranius walleri. It's such a beautiful animal with soulful eyes, but it's in grave danger of becoming extinct. And if that should happen, there are black days ahead for humanity. You see, the slogan of our society is, if it can happen to the Garanook, it can happen to you. Oh, one little thing I forgot to ask to get for us is, and I want it placed dead center on the table before our meeting tonight. With silver handles, if you can get them on such a short notice. A nice coffin, velvet lined.
A coffin?
Well, it's the symbol of our society. It symbolizes extinction. Today, the Garanook. Tomorrow, man.
The coffin.
You a wise guy or something?
The man asked for silver handles. Silver handles we ain't got. This year it's brushed copper. Take it or leave it.
What man?
Styles, convention department. We don't get calls for silver handles anymore.
A dead ringer for Peter Laurie.
Convention liaison, Styles. Well, tell him I'll be right there. Now, I've told you all about my little group. What's the scam on your little group?
What's to tell?
Oh, nothing very much. Just how long are they going to be here? What can we do to provide them with recreational facilities? And who are the likeliest candidates?
Candidates? For what?
Continuation of your present attitude, old buddy of mine, could lead to all sorts of serious repercussions. You are acquainted, I presume, with the Antitrust Division of the Department of Justice? Aware, I hope, of the strong forces in readiness available to attack monopoly in any form? Think it over. Do we divide the territory? Or do I call in the feds? Tell them I'm on the way.
Tell him to put it in Parlor 9. Todd
Stiles. Come in, come in. May I order something for you?
Thanks.
You don't mind if I continue, do you?
No, fine.
Tell me, young man, what's on your obviously troubled mind?
This afternoon, I went down to Parlor 9.
Huh?
I wanted to see if you had everything you needed. Door was open, and I started in. I overheard the debate, Mr. Karloff on one side and you on the other.
Well, Boris is a very stubborn man, and we've got to get this settled and quickly.
You can.
I
I work with you behind the scenes, you can set this whole hotel on its ear.
I know that, but we have to remain incognito.
Nobody will know except me. Now, why not run a series of test scares on selected subjects? We've got a perfect group right here in the hotel. 40 secretaries, a real cross-section. And if the old monsters are still tried and true, if they still work, you'll prove your point to Mr. Karloff, right?
That's brilliant. It's brilliant, young man. Why didn't I think of that? And how come you thought of it?
Well, nobody's all good, you know?
No, that's true. There's no such thing.
Equal pay for equal work. Now, that's what we've got to put across this year. Well, you know that right here in Chicago, a laundry clerk, if he's a man, gets $1.58 an hour, but only $1.17 if it's a woman. And in Denver, a male bank teller gets $91 for a 40-hour week, but a woman gets only $63 for the same work.
Every time I walk into his office, I feel as if I'm crossing a minefield.
Lucky you, I'd rather be yelled at than chased around the obstacle course.
Now, Nona, you don't really expect us to believe that, do you?
I'm sorry, my dear. Perhaps Lon and Peter are right. Maybe the very sight of us is enough to...
It's not you, Mr. Karloff. You are Boris Karloff. Every person born into this world is somebody new. Somebody that's never been here before. And we'll never be here again. It's our duty, isn't it, to know that? To know that there's never been anyone like her before in the whole wide world. Because if there had been, then why would she be here? And who would need her?
What's his name, my dear? The man you're in love with.
Can you tell me, Mr. Karloff? Is there anything more pathetic than a young, full-grown girl of 25 who isn't loved in return?
Case one. Instant paralysis, total loss of speech. Cases 2 to 6. Spontaneous collapse. These three passed out just from looking at me. I think I resent that.
Oh, I wish my grandson Lon was here to see this sight. You know, he was starting to not believe in me no more. But if he saw this sight, he'd have a wonderful time.
Now beat it before somebody comes along.
Oh, yeah.
This is room 1114. Would you send up a carafe of coffee? Just one cup. Thank you.
Mr. Laurie, this is Todd. 1114 just called. Now, she's one of their group. I'll leave the coffee just outside the kitchen. Tell Mr. Cheney to use the back halls. The place is in an uproar. Mr. Pavis just called a meeting of all the department heads.
Such heavy things. You look exhausted. Come on. Would you like cream or sugar? Oh, no. Oh, it's all right. I know.
Years on the cops. This is my first ape man.
Lieutenant, please. Please don't use that phrase. It's the kind of catchy thing they make headlines out of.
The boys and I interviewed 49 separate victims. Wouldn't you know we got 49 separate descriptions? Here's one that'll kill you. One of those secretaries said he was, get this, a wolf man. I tell you, some of those crooky dames.
Maybe it was a gorilla. Well, there's a circus not 5 miles from here. Perhaps the gorilla escaped.
Did you ever see a gorilla wearing a sports shirt and slacks?
I trust everybody had a pleasant dinner. Well, in that case, we'll pick up exactly where we left off this afternoon.
Is there any point in our continuing our discussions in such lugubrious conditions? Peter.
Yes?
I detest the smell of burning wax. Please turn on the lights and stop these amateur theatrics.
You see? You see what I mean? Boris is holding out for one thing, and Lon and I, we are holding out for another. Now, deep down in my heart, I know what's best for pictures. We might be less cerebral than he is, but we have more emotion. We have more emotion. And what I want is experience, and not theory.
I knew you would object to the candles. And this is why I lit them. I lit them deliberately. Because, you see, now, if I snuffed them out, I knew the room would be black.
And I knew someone would say,
Peter, turn on the lights.
I knew someone would say, Peter, turn on the lights. Now, during the darkness, Lana's placed a group of pictures in front of you. I took them earlier this evening. I want you to look at them with great interest, because the secret of drama is to make the expected become the unexpected.
These appear to be corpses, but the settings seem vaguely familiar.
And I saw this girl in the lobby only 10 minutes ago.
Well, they're not corpses. He took one look at Lon in his makeup, just one look, and they fainted dead away. 100% effective.
Not quite, Peter. Remember, there was that one girl in 1114.
Well, the exception proves the rule.
What girl? What exception?
Gentlemen, I still have not had the chance to outline the corporate structure. Now, the laws of Liechtenstein...
You listen to me. Let's take a look at all the facts about those girls that I've been frightening. There was this one girl.
Even Liechtenstein, gentlemen, may be impatient enough to change its laws if we do not come to some agreement. Old monsters, new monsters. What's the difference?
Now, you listen to me. There was this one girl. I was actually alone with her in her room. Alone. And I was growling, Boris. You know how I can growl. Well, she treated me like a charity case. She was sorry for me.
Room 1114, you say? But I know that girl. I met her tonight. I walked her back to her room. No wonder you couldn't frighten her. She's completely preoccupied, utterly absorbed in an emotion as primitive as your pattern of terror. She's in love. That reminds me. Long distance? Ring Charles Stevenson in Indianapolis. The Stevenson Ultrasonics Corporation. Charge it to room 17 and say that Boris Karloff is calling. Yes, my dear, yes, this is Boris Karloff.
What on earth is this? I come with documentary evidence and he calls Indianapolis.
Stevenson, this is Karloff speaking. Yes, yes, Boris Karloff. Mr. Stevenson, are you still there? Well, now, it's about this girl, Molly Cross. How big a fool are you, Stevenson? Don't you know how much she loves you? Oh, no, 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 I'm calling quite independently. I'm quite sure if she knew I was calling you, she'd fly away forever. Not at all, Stevenson. My pleasure. Goodbye. Peter? Lon? You did an unscrupulous thing frightening these girls the way you did, but you've almost convinced me that maybe the old ways are the best after all, that a new wave in horror pictures, the adult horror, so to speak, might be the wrong technique. But we must be sure. Using this girl, Molly Cross, as the ultimate test. If we can frighten her, gentlemen, a woman in love, we can frighten anybody and everybody.
This morning's seminar I call Our Enemy, the Boss. Now, a gal can waste a lot of time thinking her boss is a girl's best friend. Certainly, we executive secretaries know this, but from time to time, you're going to be called upon to break in new girls. Teach them this. To give the boss efficiency, performance, loyalty, but nothing of themselves, nothing of their personal selves. If they do, disillusion, even heartbreak can result. Molly, do you mind? For the last 5 conventions, I've tried to tell Molly Cross, open your eyes, stop spoiling the boss, stop letting him know how you feel. But no, not Molly. She brought him his slippers in the morning and his shoes at the end of the day. She ground his coffee for him, a special blend, mind you. She even preheated his cup. Why, geisha girls couldn't have measured up to her performance. She treated him with love and affection instead of professional detachment. And girls, I ask you to view the consequences. I ask you to look at poor Molly Cross.
Molly! Molly, would you step outside a minute? I want to talk to you.
Mr. Stevenson, you shouldn't have come all the way from Indianapolis.
Are you coming out or not?
I'm sorry, Mr. Stevenson.
Very well.
Mr. Stevenson, what are you doing?
Taking you to the justice of the peace. Molly, you're marrying me today.
But you're engaged.
I can always get another fiancé. I'll never get another secretary like you.
Please, Mr. Stevenson.
Not only have you spoiled me, but I love you.
What?
I love you.
That's the girl.
That proves it. The old ghosts are the best after all. And the power of all three of us in one picture. Can you imagine it? Why, it's almost too ghastly to contemplate.
Molly! Molly! Molly, darling, you look as though you'd seen a ghost.
I didn't see anything but you, Mr. Stevenson. I never have. It's the first time you've kissed me. I guess it went to my head.
Wait a minute. Collins is after you. I gotta find a place to hide you. Come on.
Come on.
Tell the young man who is responsible for the whole thing. Meet Mr. Karloff.
How you do?
Mr. Cheney.
How you do? I see it, but I don't believe it.
Well, gentlemen, it's been a pleasure to serve you. Now, if you'll just relax a minute, Mr. Murdoch, my assistant, and I will go out and divert the chase. Oh, I suggest you get out of those outfits as soon as possible. By the way, good luck on your new venture.
Thank you.
No hard feelings? When you warned me, you weren't just kidding, were you?
Fresh start?
Yeah, all right. Well, split the secretaries right down the middle. 19 for you and 20 for me.
Wait a minute. That makes 39. There were 40 secretaries. What happened to the other one?
Well, there's one of them, Todd, we can both forget. Molly Cross. Fairest to them all.
That way, Lieutenant!
Crazy.
We gotta put that one in for this night.
Catherine blocks the G.
Says, come on, daddy, oh, let's go. No, no, I don't want to rock and roll. I don't want to rock and roll. I'd rather stay in my pad and be your bongo beat, daddy, oh.
Talk to you of art, for there is nothing else to talk about, for there is nothing else. Life is an obscure hobo bumming a ride on the omnibus of art. Burn gas, buggies, and whip your sour cream of circumstance and hope, and go ahead and sleep your bloody heads off. Creation is, all else is not. What is not creation is graham crackers. Let it all crumble to feed the creator. The artist is. All others are not. A canvas is a canvas. Or a painting. A rock is a rock or a statue. A sound is a sound. Or is music. A creature is a creature, or an artist. Where are John, Joe, Jake, Jim, Jerk? Dead, dead, dead. They were not born before they were born. They were not born. Where are Leonardo, Rembrandt, Ludwig? Alive. Alive, alive, they were born. Bring on the multitude with a multitude of fishes. Feed them to the fishes for liver oil, to nourish the artist. Stretch their skins upon an easel to give him canvas. Crush their bones into a paste that he might mold them. Let them die. And by their miserable deaths become the clay within his hands, that he might form an ashtray or an ark. For all that is comes through the eye of the artist. The rest are blind fish swimming in the cave of aloneness. Swim on, you maudlin, muddling, maddened fools. One bright and sunny night.
Some artist will bait a hook and let you bite upon it. Bite hard and die. In his stomach, you are very close to immortality.
What are you doing here?
I was looking at Carla's picture.
Do I pay you to look at pictures? Come on, get to work.
I was just looking.
There are empty cups all over the place. Clear them out.
You shouldn't be so rough on him, Leonard.
Hey, say, Walter.
Hi.
Go cut.
Yes, man. How you making?
Fine, man. How about you?
Good enough.
Valdez, Vice.
Yeah, LaCroix checking in. Over a couple of minutes ago.
Anything new at the door?
Well, nothing you can pound nails in. A couple of hustlers. One of them short, fat, brunette, named Skinny. The other one was short also. She was bleached and skinny.
Name of Fat.
Probably. I didn't get it. They didn't give any pictures, though. Guess you can keep an eye on them.
Okay. Any heads?
Well, Jerry Sachs looked like he was straight. I'm sure he's on it anyway. Didn't see any pushers around the place. Lou said he'd check out on Jerry, sound him out later if he gets any higher. I guess that's about it.
Okay, go on home and get a good night's sleep, you think.
Okay, so long.
Everyone listen to my new poem. Do you think they really heard it?
I heard it, Mr. Brock.
Thank you, Walter. I'm sure you did.
Bring on the multitude with a multitude of fishes. Feed them to the fishes for liver oil to nourish the artist.
That was word for word.
Is it? I've forgotten.
You mean you don't remember your own poem?
I refuse to say anything twice. Repetition is death.
I don't get it.
When you repeat something, you are reliving a moment, wasting it, severing it from the other end of your life. I believe only in new impressions, new stimuli, new life.
I thought you believed that life is an obscure hobo bumming a ride on a...
I do believe that, Walter, but I also believe creative living. To be uncreative, you might as well be in your grave or in the army.
They tried to draft me once. I couldn't pass the test.
Walter, Leonard's looking at you.
He's just about gone.
Walter has a clear mind. One day something will enter it, feel lonely, and leave again.
Nice. Too much.
Yes, Katz, yes. If you want to know how beatniks live, William and me will show you. We'll introduce you to some wild ones. You may even discover an artist of your own.
And how much is that going to cost us?
What cost? A couple of bucks. You want to meet some beatniks, don't you?
Oh, no, it's the artist. I'm just crazy about artists.
All that is comes through the eye of the artist. The rest are just blind fish swimming in a cave of aloneness.
Oh, you must be an artist. And working as a busboy, too.
Feed him that he will be satisfied. The artist is. All others are not.
That's most intriguing. Are you a painter?
Well no, I work... I'm working on something that's not ready yet.
What is it, man? Finger painting?
Draw me a picture of a house, Walter. Make some smoke coming out of the chimney.
Well, I am working on something. I'll show you soon.
Walter.
Is he?
Good look, kid. Come on home.
Thank you.
Mrs. Swicker.
Oh, Walter, you look awful pale. What'd you have to eat tonight?
I had a salami sandwich, Mrs. Swicker.
Oh, if you were my son, why don't you let me fix you a nice bowl of soup? Won't take but a minute.
Oh, it's okay. I can fix myself something. Besides, I got something important to do.
Oh, say, Walter, did you see anything of Frankie tonight when you went out?
I didn't see him at all.
Well, if you do, tell him I got a nice, fresh piece of halibut for him.
Tell him that? I mean, do you think he'll understand? He's only a cat.
Good night, Walter.
Frankie? Canvas is a canvas or a painting. A rock is a rock or a statue. A sound is a sound or it's music. Be a nose. What's the matter, Frankie? How'd you get yourself stuck in a wall? Wait a minute, I'll get you out. Frankie? You all right, Frankie?
Hi, Carla.
Walter, what are you doing here so early?
Well, I brought something. I think you'll like it.
Take that stuff to the laundromat, Walter.
Huh?
Don't mind him. What have you got?
It's a thing I made.
Walter.
You like it?
What's he got?
Oh, come look at this, Lenny.
Well, where'd you get that, auction?
I made it.
You made that?
I said I did, didn't I?
Very good.
Honest?
Honest.
What's it called?
Dead Cat?
Dead Cat? That's its name?
Sure.
Well, it sure looks dead enough.
You want to buy it?
Buy it? That thing? Scare people out of the place.
Don't be silly. It's tremendous. Look at the detail. The anatomy's perfect. Look at the expression on its face.
How come you put a knife into it?
I didn't mean to.
Just got carried away, huh? Well, all right. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll put it in the corner of the alcove. If it sells, we'll split 50-50, okay?
Sure. Does this mean I'm an artist?
Maybe so. You can do other things as well.
All that is comes through the eye of the artist.
Yeah, you're a real artist now. I go in back and scrub down those garbage cans. Much now.
You really like it?
We like it. Now go on.
Did you see my cat?
What's the matter? You lose it?
How do you like my cat?
You make this thing mad?
Uh-huh.
It's crazy. Crazy.
You want to buy it?
For me, Matt?
I'm tapped. Likes my cat.
Get to work.
Hey, Waller, come here a minute. Hey, congratulations, man.
Walter, you're famous.
I saw your cat.
Did you like it, Mr. Brock?
You may call me Maxwell.
Now, how'd you do it, Walter?
Oh, just took some clay and fixed it up.
Attention. Attention, everyone. As you pass through these yellow portals, I am sure you noticed on your right a small clay figure and assumed this transfixed effigy to be the work of a master sculptor. And indeed, so it is. That master sculptor is in our midst. He is none other than Walter Paisley, our very own busboy, whose hands of genius have been carrying away the empty cups of your frustrations. Mark well this lad. His is the silent voice of creation. Within the dark, rich soil of humility, he blossoms as the hope of our nearly sterile century.
Beautiful, Maxwell.
Bring me an espresso, Walter.
Hey, Maxwell, really beautiful.
Thank you. Man, you are in.
Oh, Walter, it was wonderful.
Yes, that's a cat's cat. Yes. This is my man. Took of everything. Yes, yes. Listen, man, you got a pin? Huh? This is my man.
Hey, Pops, what's happening?
Making a big scene for Walter.
Who'd he shoot?
He made a cat. Out of clay.
See you around.
Yeah, later.
Will somebody clear this table, please?
Did you hear them, Mr. DeSantis? They all like my cat.
Yeah, very good. Now look, Walter, you must be tired. Why don't you take the rest of the night off, huh?
No, I don't.
No, you got it coming. Besides, you're creating an incident. When people are applauding, they don't order coffee. So go on home and work on something. Make another cat.
Well, I haven't got another cat.
Well, just go to the movies. Please, Walter, go.
All right, Mr. DeSantis. Good night.
Good night, Walter.
Walter? Walter, wait a minute.
Oh, hello, Naolia.
Walter, I dug it.
My cat?
It was the most wonderful, wildest, like, wiggiest thing I've ever seen. Walter, you've done something to me. Something deep down inside of my prana.
I have?
Oh, Walter, I want to be with you. You're creative. You've got a hot light bulb glowing inside of you, and I want to be warmed by it.
Gee, that's nice of you, Naolia.
Walter, take me away from here. Take me away to some cool blue place and gas me.
I can't. I gotta go home.
Oh, then I'll go home with you.
Oh, no, Mrs. Swickard wouldn't like that. She's my landlady.
Isn't there anything I can do for you?
I don't think so, Naolia.
Walter, I can't let you just split like this. I've got to do something. I've got to contribute.
You don't have to do anything.
Wait. Wait, there is one thing I can do. One little thing. Don't leave, Walter. I want to give you something. Something that'll make you remember me. Put it in your pocket. Now go, Walter. Don't look back. Just go.
Can I have your autograph, Mr. Paisley?
Why, certainly, my good woman.
Everybody likes my cat. You want to buy my statue, mister? $10,000? Okay. Gee, I'll be famous. And then I can ask Carla and she'll say yes. I know she will. Hey, you're Lou, ain't you? I seen you down the yellow door plenty. Come on in. I was just making some pancakes. You can have some if you like. Did you see my cat?
Yeah, I saw your cat. I also saw that chick lay these on you.
Oh, that was Naolia. She's a nice girl. She's kind of strange, though. I guess she figures I get headaches or something.
Okay, Walter, who's your connection?
Connection?
Yeah, connection. Who do you score from? Where do you buy your horse?
Horse?
Horse, junk, white stuff, heroin.
Is that what that is? I never seen any of that before. I always thought that was expensive.
Yeah, Walter, that can be real expensive.
Gee. Well, wasn't that nice of Naolia to give me that expensive horse?
Walter.
Huh?
Police officer.
Ooh. You're like an undercover man.
You're under arrest, Walter.
Under arrest for what?
Possession of narcotics.
For me? What are you talking about?
Walter, I got you cold. Now, you just come along quietly.
I didn't do nothing. And they only give me those. I didn't ask her for it.
All
I didn't even know what was in
right.
That.
All right, you can tell them that downtown. Now, let's go.
I ain't going no place with you.
Walter, do I have to point this at you?
You're going to shoot me. No, don't shoot
Walter,
me.
Walter, just relax.
No, you're going to shoot
now,
me.
Just relax.
No, don't shoot
just
me.
Just shut up, Walter.
No, you're going to shoot me. Don't shoot.
Are you all right? I thought I heard you shouting a minute ago. Walter! What's all the noise in here?
Noise, Mrs. Swickett? What noise?
Don't tell me I didn't hear a racket. Are you sure you're all alone?
I'm always alone, Mrs. Swickett.
Yeah. Walter, have you been talking to yourself again?
Well, I guess maybe I have, Mrs. Swickett. Somebody's got to.
Walter, you know, what you need is a girl. But she doesn't have to be pretty. Just so long as she takes good care of you.
Well, I can take real good care of myself, Mrs. Swickett.
Yeah, I can see that. Look at this pad. It's terrible. When did you ever clean it up? And when did you change these sheets last? They look like they're alive.
Now, Mrs. Swickett, I gotta meet some friends in a little while, and I gotta take a shower.
Well, why don't you clean up
this stuff?
If you don't mind.
Oh, please,
Mrs.
Swickett.
to hurt you, Lou. But if you'd have shot me, you'd be mopping up my blood now. I can't help it if I got scared and hit you. I didn't mean it. It's crazy. It's crazy. I didn't know you had it in you, Walter. How'd you do it? Well, I just took some clay and fixed it up. Go home and make something, Walter. Make another cat. But I haven't got another cat.
Well, I reported in here around midnight. Lou had already been gone over an hour. No, nobody seems to know where he went. Why don't you put an alert out on him, and I'll check on him from here. Okay, right.
They want
you, man. You.
Hey, maybe they're looking for old Walter. He's a criminal type. Ain't you, Walter?
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. DeSantis.
Oh, that's all right, Walter. Sit down.
Me? Sit down.
Greetings, man.
I'm not supposed to sit with the customers.
Wait.
Now, why shouldn't you sit at the table, Walter? After all, you're a big artist now. A true creator above mere mortals.
What's the big idea?
Idea? I was just telling Walter the truth. Man wanted to pay me $100 for the cat. In fact, he's taking it home to show to his wife. Proves that I underestimated Walter's ability. His work has enormous realism. You can hardly tell it from the real thing.
Well, that sounds like a real put down.
Get off Walter's back, Leonard.
Am I on his back?
You're not very funny.
I'm not trying to be. Walter, what are you going to make next?
A dog, maybe. Or a bird. How about a few dozen cockroaches from your room?
Hey, man, why don't you make an elephant?
I got a new one.
Great. What is it?
It's a full-length, life-size figure.
Crazy. What is it called?
Murdered man.
When do we get to see it?
Oh, anytime.
Hey, that's a pretty far out name for a statue.
I saw a statue once. It was called The Third Time Phyllis Saw Me, She Exploded.
Well, what kind of a statue was that?
I don't know. It was made out of driftwood and dipped in fluoric acid. Very wild.
What's wrong, Leonard?
Nothing.
Nothing at all.
It's the food in this dump.
Oh, man, you should try the Sorel sewer. They got wheat germ bagels. Too much.
Excuse me, please.
I think he really is sick.
So who isn't?
Sanders! Well, I've been trying to get to you all evening.
Gotta make a call. Gotta call Lieutenant Valdez.
Listen, I was wrong about my wife. She wants that cat after all. Do you hear me? I'll give you that $100 for the cat.
I can't talk to you just now.
All right, then, $200.
No. No!
$300 and that's tops.
$300 for the cat?
I know I'm going out of my mind, but I've been collecting art pieces all over Europe for years. And this boy, Walter Paisley, has got it. I want to buy his first work. And to make very sure that I get it, I'll pay you $500. $500 for the cat and the first look at his next stuff.
Someone has the cat just now, but I'll have him back in a few days. Then you can have it for the $500.
Oh, thank you, sir. I think I've made a bargain. Call me when you're ready. Good night.
Larry, you feel better? Listen, I'm going over to Walter's later after the place closes to see Murdered Man. You feel up to coming along?
The rope was fixed around his neck and a washer behind his ear. And the prison bell was tolling, but Tim Evans didn't hear. Saying, go down, you murderer, go down.
Look at the size of it.
Well, it's not really that big. I got it on kind of a stamp.
Let's see it.
I'm a little nervous. I never did a person before.
You can do anything if you set your mind to it.
It's hot in here.
You want me to open a window?
Oh, come on, Walter. Take off the sheet.
Don't you like it?
Walter, it's a masterpiece. I've never seen anything like it before. And I hope I never see anything like it again.
Neither do I.
It's hideous, and it's eloquent. It expresses modern man and all his self-pity. How did you ever find that in yourself, Walter?
Well, it wasn't easy.
What's the matter with you?
Nothing. Nothing at all.
I've never seen anyone so squeamish. What's your opinion, Leonard?
Don't ask me.
Oh, come on. Now, even you must see its value. Do you think that you or I could have conceived of such a thing, much less executed it? Well, then admit it. It's a work of genius.
I admit it. Then let's take it down to the yellow door.
No.
Why not?
I'll tell you. But you... You cover it up again, please, huh? Please. Thank you.
What is all this nonsense? Why do you want to hide it?
Well, I've been thinking. I didn't realize how much talent Walter actually had. It would be wrong to show his pieces one at a time. Dead wrong.
You're right. He should build a collection first.
Yes. That's the idea. Maybe when it's big enough, we can have a show.
A show? Yes. Just for me?
No. Well, not exactly. I mean, you take years and years. It's getting hot again. Well, it would take you years to make that many statues, but your work would be featured.
It's a wonderful idea, Walter. It's the only way to gain recognition. All the big art critics and art dealers will be there. It'll be an event.
Yes, then we can unload. We can sell this stuff for a lot more.
But... A show? How soon can we go?
Well, don't rush things. It takes time. But first of all, you've got to stop making these horrible statues. Carla and I will guide you. Maybe you can turn to freeform.
Freeform?
Well, that's the movement today.
With his talent for realism?
But you can see the direction his realism takes.
It's unhealthy.
But you said I was a genius. I don't want to be a busboy anymore. Yes. Maybe you got a point there.
You shouldn't keep working at the Yellow Door.
Look, I'm sure that man is going to buy your dead cat, so here's your fee in advance. $50. And if you need more, I've got it, so don't worry. I've got great faith in you, Walter.
Gee, $50 for something I made.
Now you're a professional.
Let's go.
Okay. Good night, Walter. Keep up the good work.
Yeah, but don't rush things. You got all the time in the world. Come on, Carla.
Good night.
Oh, sure you are, Walter.
I am. Look. Good heavens.
Я цыган, сын Боли Поли. Помню я безумные ночи. Песни, пляски, дивный звон гитар. И любви пленительный угар.
One of the greatest advances in modern poetry is the elimination of cleric. I am proud to say my poetry is only understood by that minority which is aware.
Aware of what? Why, not of anything, stupid, just aware.
Man, this place is beginning to feel like a lineup.
Yeah, baby. But don't cool out pretty soon, I'm gonna haunt somebody else's joint.
We may have to start drinking.
Отзвучали песенки цыган. Давно закрыт любимый ресторан.
Yes, man. Yeah. Yeah. That's my man. Yeah. Yes, man. Yes.
Good evening, Walter.
Good evening, Paula.
Sylvia, didn't you see me wave my Zen stick?
It's Walter Paisley.
Bring me a cappuccino and a piece of papaya cheesecake and a bottle of Yugoslavian white wine.
Yes, sir, Mr. Paisley.
Good evening, Walter.
Maxwell, how have you been?
I see the rewards of achievement have come your way.
Well, after all, I'm a successful sculptor now.
Indeed.
Hey, man, dig Walter the Wigger.
He's coming out like he just cured cancer.
Let us make the scene.
Crazy.
I was just suggesting to Walter that he try his hand at freeform.
Why do you suggest anything to Walter? Are you the spokesman for society come to put your stifling finger in his eye?
Good evening, gentlemen.
Oh, now, who invited these two down from the clouds?
Maxwell, yoo-hoo!
Clear the table, bring a bowl. I may be sick.
It's Alice the Awful, comes to spread cheer and color.
Look at my suntan, everybody.
Do we have to?
Where have you been, Alice?
I went up to Big Sur to look for Henry Miller.
You didn't find him, I hope.
No, he's in Europe.
Good.
Why is the busboy sitting here?
I'm not the busboy anymore.
That's right. Walter has become a sculptor.
Oh, really? I'm a model, you know. I only charge $25 an hour. Would you like to do me?
I just might.
Never mind that. Walter's gonna try freeform.
There you go again. I may take my business to the Sorrel Sewer.
As a matter of fact, I was going to suggest to Walter that he try a female figure. As a change from the violent death theme. You really should, Walter. You know what? If you like, I'll be your model for free.
I couldn't. Not you.
Man, if you're gonna be an artist, you've gotta do nudes, nudes.
Right. Ain't nobody an artist unless he does... nudes.
Will you get them out of here before we wind up in night court?
Oh, let's change the subject. I'm sick of hearing about sculpture. Nobody knows how to do that anymore, much less the busboy from the Yellow Door.
Who do you think you're talking about?
Don't shout at me.
I don't like you.
Nobody asked for your opinion, Walter. You're just a simple little farm boy, and the rest of us are all sophisticated beatniks.
That's all, man. Let's split.
Yeah, man. I gotta make me some air.
See, you made them leave.
What did I do?
The first beneficial service of your benighted life. It proves we're all good for something.
Are you saying that this busboy is better than I?
Yes.
I think this whole bit about him being a sculptor is just a big put-on for my benefit.
That's not true. I am a sculptor.
Oh, yeah? Prove it. Make something out of this.
There.
hand.
That isn't a real hand. If you were a sculpture, you'd create something for me.
A harpoon would be very nice.
I'm going home.
Alice, you're obnoxious.
But he's such an idiot.
I wanted to apologize for being nasty to you this evening.
So you're apologized. Good night. Listen, Twerp, why don't you get out of here and let me go to bed?
I didn't finish talking to you. I decided to make that female figure after all.
Oh?
And I'd like you to pose for it.
Remember what I said about my price?
$25 an hour.
If you want to pay it, I don't mind posing. When do you want to start work?
Tonight.
You mean right now?
Uh-huh.
Wait till I get my sweater. More heat around this place.
It's bad for the clay. You'll get used to it.
Well, I'm almost ready.
Here. Sit in this chair and I'll pose you.
Rickety. How's this pose?
Well, that's fine. It's very good. Just stay like that.
That doesn't look like very much clay.
Oh, it's enough. Put this around your neck.
Watch it. The plate's hot.
Are these fertile eggs?
Are these eggs fertile? Naturally.
What did you fry them in?
We ran out of the safflower seed oil, but I found a bottle of peanut oil on the shelf. Don't worry. It's not hydrogenated.
Is that the cold-pressed stuff or the junk Hilda bought by mistake?
Yes, man, yes. Hi.
Good morning, Walter.
Hi, Walter. What brings you here?
Had some breakfast, man.
What are you having?
And soy and wheat germ pancakes. Organic guava nectar, calcium lactate and tomato juice, and garbanzo omelets sprinkled with smoked yeast. Join us?
No, thanks. Mm. Sounds great, though. Mm. I brought something to show you. Could I have some of the guys help me?
Is it murdered, man?
It's better.
Come on.
Porters. Put it in the middle of the room.
When did you do this, Walter?
Last night. It doesn't take me very long.
I should say not.
Well, let's see it, man.
Walter, I can't believe it.
I'm honored to know this man.
Do you think it's nice?
Hey, she's beautiful.
Do you think it's nicer than Murdered Man?
Oh, I don't know, Walter. It's impossible to choose. They're both great.
Walter, I'm deeply moved. To show my appreciation, I'm going to give a party tonight at the Yellow Door, in your honor. And I shall compose a poem.
Some more champagne, Your Majesty?
Here, here.
Where?
There, there. That's fine. Madam, just have another little kiss.
Walter, you're a wretch.
I am.
Here I go. All right.
Walter. The bird that flies now pays later through the nose of ambidextrous apathy. Necrophiles may dance upon the placemats in an orgy of togetherness. The highway of life cuts sharply through the shady ghettos and the ivy-covered tombs, and laughter rings from every time capsule in the star-spangled firmament. And in the deep freeze, it is the children's hour, and no one knows that Duncan is murdered, and no one knows that Walter Paisley is born. Duncan knows. Tuesday sunrise knows. Alley cats and garbage cans and steaming pavements and you and I and the nude descending the staircase and all such things with souls, we know that Walter Paisley is born. Ring rubber bells, beat cotton gongs, strike silken cymbals, play leathern flutes, the cats and cans, and you and I, and all such things with souls, we shall hear, Walter Paisley is born, and the souls become flesh. Walter Paisley is born!
Marvelous, darling, marvelous.
Man, like that was the greatest gas I ever heard.
Crazy, what did he say?
Didn't you hear him?
No, man, I'm too far out.
Maxwell, that was magnificent.
I feel so elegant.
Walter deserved every word of it.
Makes me so glad I'm aware.
Did you hear what he said?
Yes, Walter.
All about me. It's true, isn't it?
Every word.
You'd better hold off on the bubbly, artist.
Yeah, why?
You might talk too much.
What would I say?
Most anything, I expect.
Are you two trying to ignore the rest of us?
Oh, not me, Maxwell. I wouldn't ignore you. I know what it is to be ignored.
Tell us what you're going to do next, Walter.
I'm going to make the most wonderful, wildest, wiggiest things you've ever seen. I'm going to make big statues and little statues, tall statues and short statues. I'm going to make statues of nobodies and statues of famous people, statues of actors and poets and people who sell things on television. And a statue of the mayor, and some opera singers and their intimate friends. And everybody will say, Walter, let me shake your hand. It's been a real pleasure to have known you. Alley cats and garbage cans, they know that Walter Paisley is born. Ring rubber bells, beat cotton gongs, strike silken cymbals, play leathern flutes. Tell us what you're gonna do next, Walter. I'm gonna make big statues, little statues, movie stars and poets, and guys who sell things on television. And the mayor and some officers. What you're gonna do next, Walter? What am I gonna do next? What am I gonna do next? I gotta do something before they forget. I know what it's like to be ignored.
Who are you? What do you want?
Life is an obscure hobo, bumming a ride on the omnibus of art.
Huh? What'd you say?
What is not creation is graham crackers. Let them all crumble to feed the creator.
Now, beat it. You must be nuts.
Beautiful morning, isn't it?
Was. What's that you got in the box?
Just wait till you see this.
Extra, extra. Horrible murder in furniture factory. Read about the man who got cut in half. Extra, extra. Police can only find part of it.
Leonard.
Read all about it.
What's the matter, Leonard?
You made a bust.
Yeah, isn't it wonderful? What's the matter, Leonard?
Put it down, Walter, please. Walter. Walter, listen to me carefully. I don't want you to make any more statues. Do you understand? No more statues.
Why not? I gotta make statues, Leonard. You heard Brock. They want me to make them. If I stop making them, I'll just be a busboy again.
Brock, he's behind all of this with his stupid, bitter poetry. Listen, you've got to stop him right away. I'm beginning to feel responsible.
Why? What did you do?
Never mind. Walter, I've decided to have that show for you right away. Yes, when Carla comes, we'll have her work up some nice invitations. We'll have them printed up. We'll invite the critics and the art collectors. We'll tell them.
Well, I don't see why we can't go.
Mr. Leonard DeSantis is afraid to have you come. You who buy his coffee that lure his tourists. You are the heart and soul and meat of the Yellow Door. He slighted you.
Did you get an invitation?
I did not, but I'm going anyway. Not to drink his champagne, but to see Walter's triumph. After that, we go no more.
Hi, Maxwell.
I won't say good luck, Walter.
Why not?
It would imply you could not succeed on your ability alone.
You look so handsome.
I do. So do you. I mean, you look so pretty. Oh,
thank you.
Are you ready?
Oh, we've got plenty of time.
I know, but I wanted to talk to you.
Okay, we can go now if you like. Bye.
Later, man, later.
Swing.
Man, why do you suppose Walter wants to get her alone?
Do you suppose he could be physically attracted to her?
No, man, he ain't the type. He don't get enough vitamin E.
Maxwell gave him a bottle of wheat germ oil once. Maybe he just started taking it.
What did you want to talk to me about, Walter?
Well, what kind of people do you like, Carla?
Oh, thinking people. Artistic people, I guess.
You think I'm artistic?
Of course I do.
That means you like me.
I like you very much, Walter.
I thought you did. I count how you kissed me the other night.
Oh, that was for your sculptor of the girl, your nude in the chair.
Carla, I've been alone for a long time, and I know you've been alone, because you never seem to go out with anybody, even though Leonard's always asking you to go out with him, and I just...
What are you trying to say?
Oh. Carla? I don't want to make statues anymore. I want to get married. To you.
How long have you been thinking about this, Walter?
Oh, for a long time.
Ever since you first came to work at the club. You were the only one who was ever nice to me. I didn't know you loved me until you kissed me.
Walter, I do like you. And I did kiss you. But that was because of your work. There's more to being in love with someone than just that.
You mean you don't love me?
I'm afraid that's what I mean.
But you gotta love me. Why do you think I made that statue of Alice?
Walter, I'm sorry, but
you just can't be sorry. I want to marry you.
Now, calm down, Walter, and let's go in there and then maybe when the show's over, we can talk about it.
Well, somewhere. I don't want to talk about it.
I get it. I see the whole thing now. Nobody knows that Walter Paisley is born.
Carla, will you do one favor for me?
Just about anything, Walter.
Would you let me make a statue of you?
Would you really like to? That'd make me very happy.
Okay. Tonight. I'll make a statue of you tonight. Okay?
Come on.
About a return to realism.
Yes, a one-man return. We have many artists about, but no craftsmen. This man knows his anatomy.
I'd give $1,500 for this.
After you read my review, it'll probably cost you $5,000.
So what's the trouble?
Why should you be so depressed? Have you heard the things they're saying? You can make $25,000 on these pieces alone.
I thought you put money down.
I do, but $25,000?
Leave me alone.
Out!
Man, we have come to make this scene.
Want some cappuccino, man? We got the bread.
We're not open for business. This is an art exhibit. No bums. Get out.
That art is a bum, man.
And he's sober.
Yeah, well, that's his problem.
All right, man. All right, we'll wait outside.
Yeah, you wait outside.
What's the matter?
Walter, there's a body inside that statue.
Oh, that's Alice. It's all right, Carla. Maxwell says it's all right. Let them become clay in his hands that he might mold them.
Walter, you stay away from me.
Don't you see, Carla? I made them immortal. Don't you see? I can do the same for you.
Call Val
cards. I'm going after Paisley.
I'm going with you.
Hey, man, what is the score?
Walter Paisley's a murderer.
Wow, man, I saw him chasing Carla down the street.
What's that? Nobody knows I'm here.
Walter.
Oh, no. They couldn't know. They're dead. Oh. How could they know?
Did you see him?
He's hiding around here someplace.
He can't hide just because we're in Clay and he isn't.
Walter, go home.
He won't know where else to go.
Walter, go home.
Where is he?
Soon, Lou.
We'll teach him he can't murder us and get away with it, won't we?
Walter. Walter. What you gonna do now, Walter?
Find me.
There's his room. He's gone crazy.
Paisley! Paisley, open up! Paisley!
Suppose he would have called it Hanging Man. His greatest work.
We're gonna put down with him, please.
Catherine blocks the
oh.
There was this stranger who came into our town. He was tall and had a dark look about him, and a special brilliance was in his eyes. When he looked at us, there was the feeling that he could see right down to the bottom. We may have been mistaken in this, but at the time, no questions were asked. The questions always come later. All we cared about was the mystery we sensed in this stranger, and we waited to see what would happen. One evening that was different from any other, he got us all together in the big auditorium. He stood there on the huge stage. The only light was on him, and we waited in the dark. Then out of his tallness came the chanting. First, as a whisper we could hardly hear. The flippity chip on the bippity pop. The flippity chip on the bippity pop. It didn't make any sense. We were caught up in something we didn't understand. He had trapped us without our knowing it. Possibly it was his manner. And we came alive to him as he slowly moved us with his chant through the land of hush into insistent, savage, throbbing crescendos of ecstasy, as if it were the only thing we could do. We started to chant with him. The flippity jib bum, the bippity bop, the flippity jib bum, the bippity bop. And he was up on the high stage, laughing with all his might, shouting, yes, yes, yes. But there were those among us who were jealous of his powers, who felt they should be in the center of the stage, with the light shining on them. They were against our hero and the chanting, and are going to be with him every free moment. And so, little by little, a little later, these critics set to work to make nonsense out of the sense of what we were doing. And they succeeded. They destroyed our hero's faith in himself. He didn't have it anymore. After a few disappointing times in the big auditorium, the light gone out of him, we all stopped going. And the man who had once seemed so tall and who now seems so much smaller left our town, saying no, no, no. We lived through the boredom of the time that followed, telling each other pale stories of what once was and what might have been if. We lived on histories and hopes. We did this until the miracle we never thought would happen again happened. Another stranger came into our town, and he too was tall and dark and had eyes that could look right down into the bottom of you. And he got us all together in the big auditorium. And with the light on him, we were in the dark. He chanted, the flippity-jip-bum, the bippity-bop, the flippity-jip-bum, the bippity-bop. And we joined in, and the magic was in us. And he was laughing, and all his might was with him. And he was shouting, yes, yes, yes. But there were those among us who were jealous and so forth. You know what they did. Little by little, a little later, they put us back on the narrow path. This is the way things have been in our town for as long as anyone cares to remember. By the way, how are things in your town?
Crazy.